Okay, so as you're all hurtling through space at several thousand meters per second, we should probably learn about some of the individuals who discussed this information. Wow, 400 years ago. I know, right? So there was this guy named Kepler a long time ago. And without calculators or computers and really all that great telescopes, he found, he collected all the data of the astronomers of his day, and he founded three planetary rules of motion. And the first two you need to know qualitatively. The third one is a formula which is kind of dicey. I'm going to admit my misunderstanding of how the AP interprets it, because I've seen it on the AP test, but it's not on the AP what you need to know forms. So I don't think we're going to have to do any math with it, but it does help to know what's going on. Okay. So understand that that first of all, we need to agree that the Earth is traveling around the Sun. Okay. So can we agree upon that? Okay. Yeah. So the Earth is traveling around the Sun. And the first, that's cute. The first law of planetary motion is that orbits are ellipses. Okay? They don't travel in perfect circles. Some heavenly bodies travel in more elliptical paths than others. There are a few planets that are almost making a perfect circle, but in reality, and comets travel in crazy ellipses, but what's really going on is all planets are traveling in ellipses, in ovals, around a source orbit, around a source heavenly body, a source of gravity, and that source of gravity creates what's called a foci. So you can imagine this is a comet going around the Sun, and the foci is the Sun. So if you learn, I don't know how much geometry you learned about circles and ellipses. Circles have one foci, and the radius from the object to the foci is constant. Okay. So if I draw a circle, then the radius from my shoulder to the edge of the circle is pretty much constant, and the foci would be right in the center. Okay. So that would be R, that would be the focus, there you go, drop there. And the distance from the edge to the focus would always be R. Okay. That's how you make a circle. You just take a piece of string with a radius R and you go around a central point, you make a circle. But in reality, planets and comets and asteroids and all this stuff, they don't travel around their central gravity perfectly. They travel in ellipses. And Kepler found this out and he said, huh, that's interesting. They don't travel around, but they do travel around as an ellipse with foci, and they travel around the central focus as one foci, and then there's some ghost foci out here somewhere, a ghost focus. So Sun would be one focus, and there's a ghost focus out there to make things symmetrical. Because that's just how ellipses work. If you want to go talk to your geometry teacher and say, tell me about ellipses, then they'll be like, well, ellipses travel around like a circle, but instead of every radius always being the same, they travel around the focus. Now here's the cool thing about an ellipse. The radius to any one focus is different. It's variable, it's changing. But the total radius, or the total distance to both of the foci, are constant. In other words, the distance from here to here and then to here is the same as here to here and then to here. From here to there is going to be the same distance as from here to there to there. So the total distance from any point to both foci is constant. Does that make sense? So the distance from here to here and there, that distance is the same as the dashed green distance. And the distance from this point down here to that focus and that focus is the same as, you get the idea? So any point in the orbit is the same distance to the total of both foci. Why it forms an ellipse and not a perfect sphere? Because either when the universe was created or exploded, that there was gravity pulling on objects. They weren't in perfect circles. Maybe someday they will be in perfect circles, billions or trillions of years from now, but when the universe was spoken into existence or exploded, depending on where you fall on that, that just happened to be, there were so many things pulling objects in different directions, they couldn't form perfect spheres. Okay, so does that make sense? Okay, so that's Kepler's first law, that the distance from the orbit to any both foci is constant. Cool? All right. Now, why is that important? Okay, we talked about that. Give me a thumbs up if you're ready to move on to the second law. Okay. It's important because, okay, let's try that again. I don't want all that to come up at once. Okay. Now, this is important because that means that an object has to speed up and slow down as it travels around its central gravity focus. Again, I've removed the ghost focus over here. And basically, here we have a planet. For some reason, now the planet is sweeping out, it's the Earth too, sweeping out a huge distance. Kepler's second law, he did a little algebra. Wasn't really all that much of a stretch for him. He found that you sweep out equal areas at any given time in your orbit. So an orbiting object sweeps out equal areas between itself and the focus for any given time interval. Again, I'll draw the ghost focus. Where would be the ghost focus? Case, but because we already talked about Kepler's first law, so now we're moving on to Kepler's second law, and that is from the central gravity focus for any given time, it's going to sweep out a bigger distance when it's closer to the focus. Yeah. As it's moving, if you drew a triangle from the planet to the central focus, back to the planet, or the chord, if you took the arc length, and drew a triangle from the arc length to the central focus back to where it was over a certain amount of time, it draws out the same area, whether it be close to the focus or further away. So for any given time interval, it draws out the same area. That's important because that means objects closer to their focus have to be going faster. And this is what the AP is actually... This is what we've actually found in the AP test. This actually pops up. They want you to know the what of Kepler's second law, and that is objects traveling towards the focus are traveling faster. Yeah. Yeah, same size t. So this t and this t are the same amount of time. So for any given amount of time, when the planet is closer to the focus, it has to be going faster. And since it has to be going faster, its kinetic energy is what? Greater. So on this end, the planet has a whole bunch of kinetic energy, and on this end, the planet has a whole bunch of potential energy. Okay? It still has a little bit of potential energy over here, and it still has a little bit of kinetic energy over here, but as you get closer to the focus, you have to be moving faster, so you have more kinetic energy and less potential energy. Potential energy is still mgh, but now it's still mgh, but then this is our h. And this is our h. Okay, kind of like a projectile or a harmonic motion. When you're further away, you have a bigger h, so you have more potential energy, but less kinetic energy. When you're closer, you have a smaller h, which means you have a smaller potential energy, but you're moving faster, so you have more kinetic energy. And as long as Odin, or Atlas, or Jehovah is not pushing on the planet, the total potential energy and kinetic energy the sum has to be what? Equal. The total mechanical energy of the planet traveling around the Earth, or around the sun, or the comet traveling around the sun, or whatever, it has to be equal. The total mechanical energy of the planet must be equal. Just like a swinging pendulum, the total mechanical energy is the same. Just like a launching projectile, the total mechanical energy is the same. It would only lose energy when there is an outside force applied to it, like if an asteroid hits it, or there's another object that flies nearby and because of gravitational force we're about to talk about, slows it down. Okay. The next thing we're going to talk about is Newton's law of gravity, and that is forces exist between objects that have mass. So if there any kind of outside force would change its kinetic and potential energy. Okay. Give me a thumbs up if this idea makes sense. Okay. I have never seen the AP actually ask you to calculate Kepler's third law, which I'm going to show you anyway. What I have seen the AP do is ask questions like, think about the planet. What happens to the kinetic energy as it goes from here to here? What happens to potential energy as it goes from here to here? What happens to the total mechanical energy as it goes from here to here? So if basically taking that into account, as the planet travels on its axis, let's say this is point A, and it travels to point B, what happens to the potential energy? The potential energy increases because now the H is getting bigger. What happens to the kinetic energy? It decreases. What happens to the total mechanical energy? It's equal. What happens to its velocity? Remember, velocity is tied to kinetic energy. So if kinetic energy is dropping, velocity also must be dropping. Yes? This is second law. I'm about to get to third law. We'll actually add some. Actually, second law is kind of like, yes. Yeah. Second law is kind of like the concept without the math, and third law is the concept with the math that makes the second law work. It's kind of like Newton's third and second law. F equals ma is the second law, and third law is action-reaction. The second law makes the third law work. For Kepler, the third law makes the second law work. But don't worry about the math. Third law is going to be math. Okay, does that idea make sense? So if it's dropping in kinetic energy, it also has to be dropping in velocity. Then there's momentum, okay? The angular momentum has to be what as it travels? Constant, okay? Again, without an outside force pushing on the system, it's gonna spin that way forever. And since that's the case, the angular momentum as it travels must be constant. Does that make sense? Yes. It might encounter other objects, but that might be billions of years in the future. Okay. So give me a thumbs up if what we're talking about makes a little bit of sense to you. Again, I've never seen the AP actually ask you to do any math with third law, but if it does, this is third law. Yeah. T's are periods of spinning objects. So if you had two objects orbiting the same center of gravity, then their ratios of their periods, or the square of their ratios of their periods, equals the cube of the ratio of their radii. And again, I've never seen the third law show up on AP questions, but if you're curious what it is, there it is. I also put it on the board. I think I put it on a poster. Sorry, what? Yeah. Or Earth and Mercury, or Mercury and your mom, or whatever. Just any two massive objects traveling around the sun. Awesome. And your uncle, and your aunt. I'm sorry, what? Yes. Technically speaking, every single one of you is part of the Earth system that includes the moon and anything on the Earth. All of you are little point masses in the Earth system. Remember how we talked about it's not the Earth that travels around the sun? It is the Earth and the moon system that travels around the sun. So the Earth does not go around the sun like this. It goes around the sun like this. Yeah. I'm pretty attracted. I am attracted to Torsten. Looking around the room, I'm probably the most attractive person in the room. Yeah. Well, I got so attractive. When I started teaching, I got a little more attractive than when I got married. I got really attractive when I had kids. Man, you're in for it. Just wait for it. Men and women. That's a pretty broad question. Oh, yeah. Okay, so Elias just asked one of the smartest questions I've ever heard come out of his mouth. So we're going to answer it in about 20 minutes. He asked, how does gravity affect light? And we're going to talk about that in just a second. Okay, so. No, but you're getting there. Okay, so here are, guys, understand the AP does not care about history, but I think it's kind of fun because you might actually, you might smoke your neighbors in Jeopardy, because every now and then, the science questions in Jeopardy, they love astronomy. So here's a couple guys. Anyone know who that might be? Who was the first guy who talked about gravity? Galileo. So there's Galileo. Yes. And then the guy who basically said Galileo was full of crap was Aristotle, who himself was full of crap. And then the guy who invented calculus so the math could work, Newton. And then he did it in a day. And then this guy, probably you never don't recognize him. It's not Benjamin Franklin. This guy is called Cavendish. He had a device named after him, but he didn't really get much. And then this, Grandpa. Yeah, Einstein. Okay. Okay, so Aristotle, Galileo, I'll show you. So Aristotle, Galileo, Newton, Cavendish, and Einstein. All right. So, again, the AP doesn't care about history, but it is kind of fun. So Aristotle believed in what's called natural motion, that objects have a natural tendency to do what they do. And one of the things was rocks have a natural tendency to fall on you. So we can launch a rock at our enemies, and a larger rock has a greater tendency to fall towards the earth, so it's going to fall faster than a smaller rock. And you can basically prove this by you climb a mountain or climb up a tower, like a Leaning Tower of Pisa, and you take a big rock and a small rock, and then you put two students down below, and you drop them at the same time. And do you hear ow, or do you hear ow, ow? You hear ow. So that's what Galileo did. Galileo said Aristotle's full of crap, and he said if you drop two objects, it doesn't matter their masses, two objects will fall at the same rate because gravity's pull is the same. One object doesn't have more natural motion to pull on the other one. They fall at the same rate. So that would be Galileo. That was all great. And then along came Newton. And Newton actually used the research that Kepler used, and he said, I've noticed that objects fall pretty close to the same way that planets travel around the sun. So he used a lot of research that Kepler used and a lot of stuff that Kepler published, and he looked at the planetary bodies, and he said, things fall towards the Earth, apples fall towards the Earth, students, at pretty much the same way that planets fall around stars, stars move around the center of the galaxy maybe, but anyway, And what he said was, the force between objects varies with the square of their distance. Okay, the force between objects varies with the square of their distance. And even more importantly, the masses play a role. So the masses of an object play a role in how much force is between them. Now, realize there's a special force that drags the Earth around the Sun. It is the same force that a hammer thrower drags a metal mass around himself or herself. It's centripetal, with a P, centripetal force. So the same rules that a hammer thrower would use to drag the hammer around himself, the Sun uses to drag the Earth around itself. And that gave us the formula you need to write down, which is force equals G, gravitational constant, multiplied by the mass of the target and the source object, and the over the square of the distance between them. Because it is a universal constant that God or Odin or evolution said, that's what it's going to be. G is going to be this. He's the Norse god. I don't know if he made the Earth or not. I was thinking about... Six point six seven times ten to the negative eleven, I think. Yeah, right there. Okay. So, as great as all this was, as great as this research was, and all the work that Newton did, enough that we name a unit after him, we didn't have a good, accurate value for G. We knew there had to be some constant, the gravitational constant, as far as we know, of the universe, as far as we know. The gravitational constant is some number that makes the formula work, that turns the varies with sign into an equal sign. So Newton said, the gravitational force between two objects, be they Earth and the Sun, be they a piece of lint and your face, be they the center of the universe and your mom, varies with the mass of the center of the universe, the mass of your mom, and the square of the distance between them. He said they varies with. And it wasn't until Cavendish came along, and Cavendish says, you know what? I know how to prove this. How would you prove it? Okay, so you need a force. How would you prove that anything with mass is attracted to anything else with mass? Okay. Okay, take two people who know their masses and go from there. Take a couple giant things and let them smash into each other. And that's pretty much what Cavendish did. He got a giant ball. Guys, he's obviously very intelligent. He got a giant ball of lead, and he set it right here. And another giant ball of lead, and he set it over here. And then he took a steel bar or a brass bar, and he hung the balls of lead. Actually, no, back up. He set the ball of lead here. Another set the ball of lead here. And then in between them, he took a bar, and he hung from that bar two metal masses, copper, lead, whatever. So he had a big mass right there of lead, and a big mass of right there of lead, and then he took a bar and he put on each bar another mass, and he allowed that bar to hang freely. And then he let go. And what happened? The bar moved. The bar swung towards the massive lead. Yeah, because it was allowed to move. It was a bar in between the two pieces of lead, so the bar was allowed. It's like top view. Yeah, it's like a top view. Sorry, yeah, that's a top view. So that bar was allowed to swing, and when it swung, he calculated how fast it swung. In other words, he gave us an acceleration. And if you have an acceleration and you know the mass of the bar, what can you find? Force. And if you know the force, and you, if you know the force and you know the masses and how far they are away, then you can solve for g. And that's what he did. So that was called the Cavendish balance. So he solved for g, and he found g to be 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11 Newton meter squared over kilogram squared. This is something you could do if you want. I mean, all you need is two massive things and a swinging bar. Yeah, I would recommend like a big block, like a boulder, and then maybe your mom. Something massive on both ends. You can try your mom. Something massive on. You have to have a lot of mass, because otherwise the acceleration will be so small that friction in the pivot will overcome it. It has to be big.